I'm Common Sense. Today is October 15th, 2020, and this is the Black Men's Book Club. Welcome today. So, before I get too heavily into this, today I wanted to tell you guys all out there in internet land, thank you for showing up, whoever you may be, however you may be, and whatever you may be listening on. I've recorded a couple episodes, and those episodes are going to serve as pilot episodes. So this is my first official episode, and I want to thank you guys all for listening. But before I get ahead of myself, I want to explain who we are, what we are, and what our mission is here at Black Men's Book Club. Who are we? Black Men's Book Club is not a physical book club that you can meet with. It's more of a virtual thing than anything. We have a fan page on Instagram that you can join. It's called the Black Men's Book Club. It's not exclusive to men. Women's voices and opinions are just as valid. This show is for all. We're all in this together. Now, what are we? The best way I can explain this is to quote the famous lawyer, Randall Robinson, the founder of Trans America. The quote is simple. Black people need a ministry of information, and with this show, we attempt to fill that void. Black people and other people of color don't have many spaces where we can have candid and honest, difficult discussions with each other. So in the immortal words of Big Will from Robots, see a need, fill a need. Now, what's our mission? American history is revisionist at best. After learning the American version of historical events, one would be led to believe that black people were just sitting there waiting for white people to come and deliver history upon them. Prior to the European invasion of Africa, we've been told that we don't have any history. And we've also been told that we've had little to do with the advancing of society. Our mission is to correct these misconceptions. Black people were not standing in one place just waiting for white people to civilize them. We have a rich history prior to, during, and after slavery. We have books and historians to tell us about it. And at Black Men's Book Club, we're going to tell you about that. Now, I'd like to cover a few rules that we have here at Black Men's Book Club before I introduce my guests. Rule number one. The black family is the most sacred thing on this planet. This includes women. We do not disrespect women. They are our wives, our mothers, our sisters, and our daughters. They are our family and our allies. We speak for them, but most importantly, we listen. Rule number two. We discuss our faith, but we will not disparage another one's. We are more alike than we are different. Cross-talking religion is encouraged, however, but only when pointing out the similarities between the two religions. The word race is a dirty word and should be treated as such. The concept of race was created in the 1700s and attached to everything solely for the purpose of advancing white supremacy. A person cannot know what they have not learned. Not knowing a fact should not be a strike against some person. Black people come in all shades, sizes, creeds, and social statuses. No one man or woman is the arbiter of blackness, and we will not measure how black someone is or if they are black enough or not. Six, we can disagree. Hell. We should disagree, it's human. But what we cannot do is demean each other. Insults are the language of people who don't have the vocabulary to properly explain their emotions. Be better than that. Seven, last, no matter how much you disagree with someone, allow them to complete their thought before rebutting. Everyone has a voice. Now that all the formalities are out of the way, let me introduce my guests. I'm calling back D. D is an educator, a socially conscious black man, a grandfather, a father, and a hell of a drone operator here in California. Welcome back, D. How you doing?
It's good to be with you and everybody in the audience.
Right on, right on. And in my third chair, I have with me a YouTube channel. In my third chair, I have with me a YouTube creator. His name's Drekon, and his page is about creating better black men. Am I correct?
Building stronger men.
Welcome, Drekon. How you doing?
Welcome on Common Sense. Pleasure to be here, brother.
Roger. So, In 2020, it's difficult for us to find any things that make us necessarily feel good. So I'm going to ask you two for a feel good story if you have one. But first, I'd like to start with D. D, do you have a feel good story for me?
Yeah, you know I do.
Come on, let me get it.
Yeah, I was thinking about this.
Stop. I never turned you up.
Okay.
That's why I couldn't hear you.
Yeah, I never turned you up. So,
okay,
I'm going to go back to my introduction. Welcome back, D. How you doing?
It's good to be here with you and everybody in the listening audience.
Roger that. And now, Drekon, how you doing?
I'm doing all right. Thank you for having me.
Roger that. So if you're wondering what happened out there in listener land, I forgot to turn their levels up. So you were hearing them through the backside of my microphone. So, all right. So it's a work in progress. All right. Now, D.
Yes, can
you give me a feel-good story? It's 2020. I need something to make me feel good.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You know, 2020 has been dominated by, COVID, all that. But, you know, life finds a way. And I'm happy to say that yesterday I was at a gathering of a lot of people. They were all ages, from newborns to great grandmas and grandpas. And everybody found a way to be able to get together, socialize, play, pray, eat, laugh, joke, and stay physically distant. And it was just a marvelous thing to witness. I ended up sitting down one time when I finally kind of came into the group, you know, and I was amazed at the sun setting and looking at all the people, you know, just enjoying themselves. It was very uplifting, and that's why I share this story with you.
Right on, right on. So was this all family? You said friends as well?
This was family and friends and new people that had come to the group for the first time, who were absolutely amazed at the, you know, the harmony between all the different people that were there. And so, in a sense, they've become family too.
Right on. You know, I haven't been able to make it out of my house anywhere. This COVID thing has really been kicking me in the butt, because my wife is, you know, one of those people who we don't even want to take any chances with it, with her health. You know what I mean? I personally can't make it without my wife. I don't know.
I understand. You know, neither can I.
You know, so I'm glad to see somebody's out there enjoying that, the fact that there's still a life to have. So, Drekon, you got a feel-good story?
Man, I have a couple. My life seems like one feel-good adventure after the other, after I started making better decisions. The most beautiful woman in the world, or my wife, it was about May, and, you know, during the whole COVID thing. And June, Father's Day. And she gave me a card, but the card was really bulky. I'm like, why am I getting a Father's Day card? Okay, whatever. And I opened it up, and it was a positive pregnancy test. And I think I ran and screamed.
Yeah,
and I just true. Jumped through the house. We're still technically newlyweds. It was just,
congratulations.
Thank you. That's it, right. Was just awesome to receive that news, to know that we're adding to our family. And I've just been, I don't know, just still excited by that. Nothing has really gotten me down, you know, because you're wondering what this next child is going to be like.
Right.
Is it going to be a boy or is it going to be a girl? And, you know, we're arguing over names, you know, but lovingly, respectfully. But it's my turn, because she got to name the last one. So.
Oh, man. You know what? My wife, me and my wife did the whole arguing over name things. Now, this is for my second daughter, right? Before we knew it was a girl. And so we're looking at names, boy and girl, what it could be. And I wrote down, jokingly, the name Assassin.
Ooh. I like it.
Right. She did too. I was like, stop it. We can't name our child Assassin. If you name him Assassin, there's only literally one thing that they can ever do for a career.
Yeah, that's right.
You can't have an assassin who's an accountant. I'm just saying. No, you know what I mean? It doesn't fit. Oh, man. But congratulations on that, brother. Congratulations on the new addition to your family. That
Thank
is
you.
Amazing. Oh, man. I'm so happy to hear that.
No better news than that. I mean, just to know that there's life growing in your wife's stomach, I just praise God every day. And to have the life that I have, I'm just humbled and in awe. Thank you very much.
Right. Man, that's amazing. Well, I'm not giving a feel-good story, because that's what my guests are for. I don't have to say anything about that one. So we're going to move on. Today, let's talk about, well, I'm going to tell you guys all what we're talking about today. So
bring it on.
We're going to talk about the black holes a little bit, for those who haven't seen or don't know what the black holes are. And the reason for this is I'm not going to talk directly about Dr. Joy's book, because it's not my place to ruin the material in her book. If you want to know what's in Dr. Joy's book, I encourage you to go out and buy that book and read that book. Now, what I'm going to do is we're going to have a discussion about things, topics that are brought up in the book. And one of those topics brought up in the book is the black holes. Right. Now, what I plan to do is at the end of the month, maybe not this month, there's a larger plan I'm working on. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to work with a publisher who's going to allow me to have my listeners pay a fee, maybe a monthly fee, and we'll send out the books that we're covering every month. But with sending out those books, that also allows you a couple extra shows, right? One of those shows is going to be a discussion where, since I'm having a show, a monthly book, I'm going to have four other episodes that are free episodes, right? But then everybody who I've brought in to talk to me about the book for one of the free episodes, I'm going to try and bring them all back for one big group discussion where we'll really dive into the book and talk about the contents of the book. I'm not comfortable talking about the contents of a book unless I know that you've bought that book. You see what I'm saying? So that's part of the reason. That's part of the reason for the monthly subscriptions, because if you're listening to that show, I know that even if you haven't read that book, you bought that book.
Mm-hmm. So let's see how that works out.
So I'm not disrespectful to the author either.
I'm behind you, man. That sounds great. I think that's a cool thing to do. I'll subscribe and I'll be here.
That's the idea, is to also I'm encouraging people to read, but I'm encouraging people to support these authors as well. So I don't want to steal anyone's intellectual property. I'd rather make sure that I know that I've done my part to make sure people have purchased the book before I give them the goods. You know what I mean?
I'm glad you mentioned that, because at some point I was thinking that, for many of us, books are books, and we may not read. They may become tedious or difficult or, a hassle. But I would urge folks to think about it a different way. The books tend to be kind of like a friend. You know, it's a conversation that somebody has written out and printed. And in that sense, you share their thinking with your own. So I don't mind paraphrasing, because the sentence or the paragraph that I use, you know, will allow me to be able to expand upon it through my own references, my own points of view, and so forth. So again, I would urge people to think of it not just as a book, but as a book that's carrying the thoughts of someone else. And in that sense, it's like a conversation.
Exactly. 100%. So we're talking about the black codes, but then I also have this this essay that I want to read about something that's not necessarily the black codes, but black codes adjacent. And we all live in California, and I'm pretty sure none of us have ever heard of it prior to what I'm going to say. So it's a dark story. It's a super dark story.
Bring it on.
Come on.
I'm ready.
All right. So I'm going to save that for the end. But before we go too much further, let's jump into the segment that I wanted to talk about, or something that we're going to do every show. And that's a couple of news stories that we think you should know about. So we're not reporting the news, but what we are doing is we're going to tell you a story that is in the news and our honest opinion about said story. You know what I mean? Because we're not reporters, and I don't want to come off as reporters, but there's things out there that I think people should know about. So the one that I'm going to start with is about I believe it's Rochester Diocese in New York. Have you guys heard about this?
If it's diocese, it must be a Catholic church, I'm guessing.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
No, I haven't, but I'm all ears.
Okay, well, they're the latest diocese to officially file for bankruptcy.
Okay.
The reason... Yeah. Okay, so you know where I'm going
it's
with
becoming
this.
Becoming clearer.
Yeah. So what's happening is the Catholic Church is treating these individual dioceses as if they are separate entities from the church, so that when enough sexual abuse allegations mount up, they can't sue the Vatican, but they can only sue the individual diocese, which cuts dramatically the amount of money that they should be receiving.
Wow.
Right. But you can't go after the Vatican. You can only go after the individual diocese. And then all they're going to do is just keep moving priests around and nothing ever changes.
It's horrible, man. That's horrible.
Yeah, it's ugly. And it's not something that I... Man... It's part of the reason why I'm atheist.
Mm. You know, with any organization, it seems that the longer that they're around, the more corrupt they become. Although I got to say, the Catholic Church started pretty interesting, under Constantine. But wow, sorry to hear that.
Yeah, that's ugly. It's ugly. And then they make public statements that suggest that they're trying to make sure that, or they're trying to ensure that all of the victims get their just rewards. But then they go and fight against it tooth and nail. Every opportunity they get, they fight against it. It's ridiculous.
Every institution made by man in some way has to self-perpetuate. They have to. There's no way they can deny themselves. And instead of it being, we told a lie or we messed up, it becomes a paradigm shift, or, it's swept under the rug, and that's horrible. That's horrible.
Right, right. He with power, he who controls the narrative, right? D, you look like you got something.
Well, before I mention that, it might be good for you to define what paradigm shift is.
Well, I guess it would be in the case of, like, pedophilia. It would be, oh, well, we never... condone that, but then there are other things that they're doing or saying, other laws that they have that are adding to that. Because I believe their priests can't even marry, they can't date, they can't. I mean,
well, that's always been the thing with them.
With them, but it doesn't say it in the Bible that a priest shouldn't, a pastor, a priest, that he
that's
shouldn't
true.
Date. It actually came about when they started losing land, because when their priests would divorce their wives would get to take half or take certain things. So it was to conserve and build up their power that they started to put that in, as if it were ex cathedra, which it wasn't from God if you're reading the Bible, but I mean, that's how it is. Like I said, every organization has to self-perpetuate. Right. You know, right. No organization is of God per se. None is. Not one.
Okay. I think paradigm is a psychological word. It comes from the field of psychology.
Yes.
Right? Can we all agree?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay. And I was just thinking that to have our listeners understand that a little bit better, because it's kind of like a big, heavy word.
I'm sorry.
You know, what you said was true.
Yes.
And as a way of trying to expand it, because we are black men sitting here and having dialogue, you know, I think, or what would you think if I were to say mental construct?
Sounds perfect to me.
You know, maybe, what do you say? Point of view?
Point of view.
You know, how about opinion?
Opinion, yes.
Yeah, yeah. And we all got them.
We all have point of views. We all have opinions. Yeah. And to make any, I'm going to say this, and at the risk of offending anyone, I'm going to say this, to make any organization where the organization is godly, I think is a step in the wrong direction. As if we speak for God, I think is a step in the wrong direction. That's just my personal opinion.
Well, yeah, but as an atheist, it's hard for me to have this conversation without talking about how it was wielded as a weapon. Like, there's people who believe in Christianity, and then there's people who use Christianity. And people who believe in Christianity are not a problem. But people who use Christianity are super problematic and dangerous. Dangerous.
Amen.
To this day, you've got people like Alex Jones, who is a pseudo-religious preacher. And he's not intentionally a preacher. You know what I mean? He's a conspiracy theorist, and he knows he's a conspiracy theorist, but he can invoke the name of God to get people to listen.
And Uncommon, that is horrible. And that's why I said there's nothing, no man now speaks for God. If he claims to, then he's wrong. I'm sorry to say that. No mm-hmm. man now speaks for God.
Exactly.
100%. No man now speaks for God. And I just want to say that, yes, the Bible is a recipe book. And just like any recipe book, whether you're baking a cake, whether you're making a soup, what do you have to add to make that thing worse or to make that thing deadly? You add poison. So anything in the Word of God, you can take it to mean or use it for something else, to lambast, to beat someone down, and to actually keep them away from God. And that's what has been used in Christendom. But if we read the words of God or Christ and let that speak for itself, I believe that it's different from what they're wielding. That's just personally me.
Right.
You know, because in my life, the Word of God has brought renewing, it's brought refreshing. The Holy Spirit has filled me, and it's been a wonderful thing. It saved me from what I used to be, and that's all I can say, you know?
It's because you're a believer as opposed to a user.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
You said something that kind of struck a nerve with me, because there's a lot of people who believe that because they're religious, that they wield the power of God. As an atheist, I say things about religion, I point to hypocrisy, right? And it's up to you to take it where you want to take it. Now, I made a video on TikTok that was pretty popular, and it was about the curse of Ham. Are you familiar with this one?
Very familiar with the curse of Ham. Yeah, he saw his father naked or something uh-huh. like that, and he cursed Canaan.
Right.
He cursed Canaan, your descendant, and the Canaanites were wiped out.
You said the exact reading that I said. He cursed Canaan, right? Who cursed Canaan?
It was Noah.
Noah cursed Canaan.
He cursed his grandson. Yes.
His own grandson.
Yes.
Because his son seen him naked.
Yes.
And supposedly, what was the curse?
The curse, I don't remember what the curse. Wiped out, right?
No.
Do you know the curse?
What was the curse?
The mark.
Wait. Yeah. Shem and Ham shall dwell in tents together, but he wouldn't, or something like that?
And the Canaanites would have to be slaves to the Shemites or the Hamites or something like that. But yeah, the way
it real deep.
The way that it was flipped for the purposes of slavery.
Yeah.
The way that it was flipped was, I know in the scripture, the actual curse is that they become albino.
The mark.
They become albino. The white skin is the curse. But for the purpose of slavery, slaves were taught that the descendants of Ham they became dark.
Right.
And that they were cursed to be slaves. And then later on in Deuteronomy, it tells you that you need to be subservient to your masters on earth. You see what I'm saying? And so I kind of made a point that there are scriptures that were used to justify slavery, and the religious zealots came at me.
Who?
A lot of them.
Oh, on a oh, lot of them. Oh, oh, you internet, so I'm sorry.
But there's different forms of the Bible too. So yeah. Which one did you learn? And did you take time to learn whether or not I was just making things up or if that's something that was actually said to people? You see what I mean? People just feel like, oh, you're coming at my religion. No, I'm not coming at your religion necessarily. But there are still versions of the Talmud that have that exact story.
I would say, Uncommon, that those people lack understanding. I mean, at any cursory reading could tell you what happened. I'm familiar with the story, but I haven't read Genesis in probably a couple of weeks, couple of months maybe. And I know that he was cursed, and there's no way, I think, that you can get that, you know, I mean, because Canaanites were wiped out. So how could you get now black people to be subservient to everyone else? I don't know how you get that.
It's mental gymnastics. There's a lot there.
And you know what? That's what Christendom has done. That's what America, the founders of America, have done in the name of Jesus. And Jesus never ratified it. Jesus was never standing next to him. Yeah, I like that. They came in, you know, Plymouth Rock and all that, and they said, well, these redskin people, the Indians, they're the Canaanites, so we're going to manifest destiny on them. That was all them. That was not God.
You know, before we finish, I want to finish up on this topic, but I'm going to say one thing about the curse of Ham before we go. And if you don't necessarily just want to look at the way the curse of Ham was used to justify slavery, you can also look at Rwanda in 1994. There was a genocide there with the Hutus.
Yeah, the Tutsis and the Hutus.
The Tutsis and the Hutus, right? Yeah. Or the Hutus.
Hutus.
Now, the curse of Ham is directly responsible for that.
Really?
Because when the Europeans moved in, they used the curse of Ham and they started telling the Tutsis that they were the descendants of the original Jews. Mm-hmm. And they created a power dynamic where they said, well, you guys, we're going to give you guys power because you guys are the quote-unquote Jews. You see what I'm saying? And when you create a power dynamic like that within the country, especially a country that had just been colonized, what do you expect to happen? It took about 20 years, but there's a large genocide. What was it, 800,000 people?
That's horrible. Was it more than that? Yeah, I thought it was like a couple million. Yeah.
No, that's the official low numbers is 800,000.
That's heartbreaking.
Go ahead.
That's heartbreaking for someone to use the word of God in that manner as a weapon to destroy people. And those people will pay. I mean, God is just. God is just, you know?
I sure hope so.
God is just.
I sure hope so.
Yeah, God is just.
Amen.
All right, so moving on. Did you have a new story you wanted to talk about?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do. It's hard to beat that one, you know, because we could talk about that for a long time.
I'm here, baby. I'm here. You guys are so kind. Yeah. I really appreciate it. You know?
Right on, brother.
The new story that I wanted to share is you know, I've been studying black history for a while. You know, we're sitting in a room that's filled with a lot of, you know, history. Some of the books I read a long time ago, and I thought they were out of print, but they were rediscovered. And I say all of that to say that it's a journey. You know, it's kind of like a learning journey. I found out something just by flipping the TV channels that surprised me. I thought I knew a little bit about some of the you know, the black towns that were developed independent of, you know, the rest of the country. I knew about Weeksville in Brooklyn. I knew about Rosewood in Florida. I knew about Allentown here in California, and there were others. But yet, I learned about one that I had never heard about before.
Wait for it.
Yeah. Drum roll. Seneca Village.
Oh,
Seneca
Central
Village.
Park.
Yeah, in Central Park.
New York Central Park.
I've never been to New York.
I'll let him tell it.
Incredible. You know, I like say, what? You know, and they showed where it was. Oh, yeah, I used to hang out over there. I mean, you know, I did not know about this African-American conclave that was in the middle of Central Park. I can kind of hypothesize as to why it was there. You know, but the fact is, it's a smack in the middle of New York City, you know, and I think it was somebody sold some land and they split it up into a whole bunch of, you know, plots, and they had a thriving town, you know, as has happened all over the country. So there's a lot to think about, but I just want to share the amazing, like, oh, there's something new to learn from black history. And I think we all need to keep studying. Even after all these years, I'm still learning new stuff.
The story of Seneca Village is actually pretty sad because it's a great tale in gentrification. The black community there started to build up a little town, like you said, right in the middle of New York City. And as a result, you know where that is. That's Manhattan, right?
Yes.
That's right in
Manhattan,
the middle.
Smack in the middle of Manhattan.
I am unfamiliar with
surrounded.
He's a New Yorker.
Yeah. Oh, surrounded by, you know, like, you know, skyscrapers all over the place. You know, I mean like skyscrapers, not, you know, 10 stories or 20 stories. You know, I mean, these are like 30, you know, 20, 30, 40 stories high, you know. And now many of them are condominiums. So many people from all over the world want to buy there that, you know, like you can get an apartment, which is basically bigger than a house. It's like a mansion sized apartment, you know, and you're paying, I don't know what the rate is now, but I used to hear about Roberta Flack being in there and it cost her, you know, a couple of million dollars. I'm sure the prices have been bid up to, you know, 30, 40, 50 million dollars. Yeah. Know?
Right. So it's the desired place to live, man.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. Guess what would have been bad for business? A bunch of niggas right there in the middle of the city.
Yeah, and this goes back to the early 1800s. It shows that, you know, left to our own devices, we are creative people. We are motivated people. You know, we can do things. We have done things. So the point I'm trying to make is that they were dispossessed. Essentially, that's it. So that's like an early gentrification story, like you just mentioned.
Right on. You know, that actually kind of segues really well into my essay, even though my essay is for the end of the show. But my essay is another example of that on steroids.
Now, I mean, not to cut you off on comment, but I've heard of what is it, Greenville, Ohio? I've heard of that one, yes. Where the first nuclear air warfare was done on American soil to the black community of Greenville, Black Wall Street, right? And they dropped dynamites from airplanes.
That was Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Tulsa, I'm sorry.
1921.
Okay, Tulsa, Oklahoma. So that I've heard of that.
Yes.
So it was something similar to that?
No. Okay. That was a violent takeover, Tulsa. What happened in Seneca Village was more just gentrification.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they wanted it, and so they started writing laws and doing what was necessary to take the land legally, or they created the legal precedent to take the law.
I think it's better to say it that way.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's going to segue into what else we're going to be talking about.
Yes. They create,
you know, just like law. You know, we're not talking about law like, you know, physics or divine law, you know, which is consistent, stays the same, it's constant. You know, we're talking about law, but it's really just code. You right. See, it's like a legislative code, a legal
redlining
code.
And things like that.
Well, what you'll find is the black codes were just a continuation of the slave codes. And Jim Crow was just a continuation of the black codes. What they did is they just brought it back unofficially, but with just a little bit lighter, because they know now they can't necessarily lynch you and walk away from it, you know? All right, well, shit, in 2020, they might be able to. I don't know.
So you think it's getting worse now?
Oh, absolutely.
Wow.
Well, guys, before we start talking about it now, let's go back, because I think our listening audience needs a little bit of perspective, and that Amen. Can come from history.
Amen.
Right, right. So we're going to take, how about we do a quick read?
Okay.
We'll do a quick read. We'll read the section from the book, the section that Dr. Joy does on black codes.
Very good.
And then we'll listen to her explanation of black codes, and then we'll take a quick break and we'll come back and we'll get into our discussion. How about that?
Amen. Sounds good.
That works. Right.
So we're going to grab a book. The book is right here. That is on page 64. Or do you want to read it, Mr. D?
No, you read it.
Oh, man.
You read it.
I always get to do all the good stuff. Okay. After the Civil War, despite the heroic efforts of black and white abolitionists whose names and sacrifices remain neither celebrated nor acknowledged, embittered white Southerners were still concerned about regaining control over blacks, while the many Northerners afraid of blacks would overrun their communities. The major problem was what to do with the millions of blacks whose freedom had just been granted. The South's solution to the problem was the introduction in 1965 of laws to control movement and activities of those recently freed, known as the Black Codes.
Correction.
1865. I'm sorry, I said 19. Okay. Although the codes were worded differently in each state, the consequences were generally the same. Almost every part of a black person's life was regulated. Southern plantation owners needed labor, so many states decreed that blacks had to work for any wages the plantation owners deemed fair. If a black man or a woman was found not working, they could be arrested for vagrancy. These codes set out what work blacks were allowed to do, where they could do it, and what hours they could work. The code prevented blacks from owning land, voting, suing, sitting on juries. Often these codes defined when, where, and with whom blacks could travel. Fortunately, within a couple of years, the federal courts ruled these codes too harsh and overturned them, claiming that whites and blacks should be subject to the same laws and penalties. Even though the black codes lasted only a short period of time, it is easy to see how they set the stage for what was to follow. Whites were not going to idly sit by and let blacks prosper. The solution in the North was the introduction of exclusionary laws that restricted the number of blacks allowed to stay in their territory. Oregon was among the states that enacted laws of exclusion, and these articles from its constitution adopted in 1859 were typical. Article 1, Section 35. No free Negro or mulatto not residing in this state at the time of the adoption of this constitution shall come, reside, or be within this state, or hold any real estate, or make any contracts, or maintain any suit therein. And the legislative assembly shall provide by penal law for the removal by public officers of all such Negroes and mulattoes, and their effect and their effectual exclusion from the state for the punishment of persons who shall bring them into the state or employ or harbor them. Article 11, Section 6. No Negro, Chinaman, or mulatto shall have the right of suffrage. One justification for the exclusionary law was fear by whites that blacks would intermarry with Indians and form an undefeatable army that would annihilate them. This was the commonly held belief during this period and was expressed frequently by politicians. Samuel Thurston was a delegate to the United States Congress from the Oregon Territory. Speaking before Congress in 1850, in defense of his exclusionary acts, he argued, "The Negroes associate with the Indians and intermarry, and their free ingress is encouraged or allowed. There will be a relationship spring up between them and the different tribes, and a mixed race will ensue, amicable to the whites, and the Indian being led by the Negro, who is better acquainted with the customs, language, and manners of whites than the Indian, these savages will become much more formidable than they otherwise would, and the long and bloody wars will be the fruits of the commingling of the races. It is the principle of self-preservation that justifies the action of the Oregon legislature." And that is the end of that quote.
Absolutely so, amazing.
Right. It's amazing that you're not, they're going to argue about you in front of your face as if you're not a human.
Let's pick it apart.
We will, but we're going to pick it apart a little bit after we take a break. So I'm going to ride out to the song. This is by Music Soul Child. Well, it's a Robert Glasper song. I apologize. But it's featuring Music Soul Child and Chrisette Michelle. I hope you guys like this one.
With someone you like, and a few things we've got, what it takes to go the distance, I can tell you now. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. Oh yeah, oh yeah.
Check, check.
Check, check.
Check, check. Check, check.
Okay, we're looking good. And we're back. Well, hope you guys enjoy the musical tunes today. Today's musical tunes are the feature of Robert Glasper. In case you aren't familiar with Robert Glasper, he's a pianist and a jazz artist, but he's not just a jazz artist. He's also a pretty well-known hip-hop producer. So when I say I like jazz, that song that we just listened to, it didn't sound very jazzy. People look at me like they think I'm talking about, John Coltrane and Miles Davis, which I am. But jazz has evolved over time, and I like to highlight different artists on the show. So we're going to do that. We're going to write into a song. We're going to write out to a song, and we're going to take a short break in the middle to a different song of the same artist on every show. Today, that's Robert Glasper. So I hope you guys enjoyed that. Well, back into the meat of our show. We're here and we're talking about the Black Codes. So what did the Black Codes look like? I went looking for this information, and it's pretty hard to say, because the Black Codes were different in every state. They really varied. So what happened is, it started with, I believe, Alabama's vagrancy law. And once they created the law, well, then the neighboring state, Mississippi, said, well, we're going to create the same law. So then Louisiana comes up with the same law, and they all copycat each other. But they would write what were effectively the same laws, but with different wording from state to state. One example of this is the Vagrancy Act of 1866 from Virginia. This was signed into law on June 15th, 1866, and it was a law that prevented people from rebuilding their lives, basically, after they were freed. It said that any person who appeared to be unemployed or homeless were so-called vagrants, and they would be recaptured and forced to work under ball and chain for no compensation. And this was more commonly known as the Act for Providing Punishment of Vagrants. It was instituted directly after the Civil War. You ever heard of that one? Or any other vagrancy law similar to that one?
No, I can't say that I have.
Yeah.
I have.
Okay. It's ugly. It's ugly because effectively what they're doing is they're telling you, you have to work, and you can only work for certain jobs for certain pay. It's slavery. They're forcing you back into employment for white people, for the benefit of white people, and you have to pay. Well, what
allow us to say this. It is slavery. However, would it be more accurate to call it forced labor?
Right. I mean, is that semantics? Because the first thing I thought to myself was, is it? Well, shit, what's the difference? You know, I think you can get away with calling it forced labor because that's the 2020 term for it, right?
Yeah.
That's the 2020 term. It's forced labor. I've heard that in other places before. And I don't disagree with that.
Right.
I don't disagree with that.
But, its intent was the same. Yeah. Sure.
And,
right?
And I guess the reason you wouldn't call it slavery is because that minimizes slavery. Because slavery there was pain involved with slavery.
Oh yeah.
You know, there wasn't necessarily pain involved with it, but there was definitely a point where they were going to take your livelihood.
Not physical pain is what you
right,
mean.
Right.
Sure, there was emotional pain to whoever was involved in that. Because at my cursory reading of it, what kind of struck me was the fact that you had to sign the contract. And if you left or you were unable to pay the planter back or the boss, was that another person, another planter, another plantation owner could step in and buy your contract, and then you're paying him back. So you never really get ahead, and they grant you tools, they grant you things, but you never make that money back up. You'll basically continue working for them forever for barely anything.
Well, what you're explaining is something. It was an addition to the Black Codes that was known as the slave peonage system. And what this was is where your employer would encourage you to work off your debts, so that they wouldn't actually have to pay you. And believe it or not, this stuck around until the 1940s. And what happened is most of the time the workers will become indebted to the owner.
So
see what I'm saying?
That would be indentured servitude, right?
Right, and this lasted until the 1940s. You see what I'm saying? And really, what you're talking about is the birth of sharecropping. That's how sharecropping came to be, because you start working under this system where you're working off your debt. You're providing work for what the debt keeps growing, and the debt grows faster than the income grows. So at some point, you might as well just stay here, and I'll let you stay here just so you can keep tending my crops, and I own you. But you're not my slave.
That's evil. That's evil.
Yeah.
That's evil.
Yeah, it is. And the worst form of this that we know of, the state and local level were complicit. You're talking about the beginning of the convict leasing system, where the state and local, at the state and local level, they would make laws where they would snatch you up. The vagrancy laws were part of this. And the rest of the Black Holes are part of it, but they would make these menial laws where they'd snatch you up, and then they would take you, and since the state now owns you, they can sell your labor, right? They sell your labor to these local people, and so now they don't even have to pay you anymore. They pay the state.
Wow.
It's all a big circle. It's all connected.
It's all connected.
It's all connected. You have to look for how it's connected. Did you know that they also created laws that prevented you from choosing where you worked at? So if you were already working for somebody, you couldn't quit and go to a new place of employment without your current boss's permission.
That's antitrust, right? Like, that's what it would be called right now.
That's what it would be called now.
I think either Google or Microsoft got busted for that, where one of them wouldn't hire the other one if you worked for one of the other ones. They're getting busted. These are multi-billionaires getting busted for that.
It's crazy, right?
That's horrible. That's going on right now.
And then they also made laws to piggyback on those same laws that suggested that you couldn't, as a white person, you couldn't offer employment to somebody who was employed by somebody else unless they got out of that contract with their current employer.
Yeah, antitrust.
So in that case, it's not employer, it's owner.
Yeah, that's evil, bro.
Right?
Yeah, that's... Also, I mean, around this time or what, within 20 years or so after the Civil War, that's when the KKK really rolls up, because they feared the black man, right?
I think that came a little later.
Because Birth of a Nation was early 1900s.
That was 1910.
Yeah.
That was, something like that.
And that was the Ku Klux Klan protecting white womanhood from the vagrants.
There was three rises of the Klan.
Uh-huh.
There was the rise in the 1890s. There was the rise in the 1920s. And then there was the rise in the 1950s. And now, if you want to consider what's going on in 2020, a fourth rise.
Wow, where am I at?
But see, it's interesting. I happen to know a lot about the Klan. I'm one of those people, because I'm a glutton for punishment, I will go on the Klan website just to read their newsletter.
Wow.
You see what I'm saying? Like, I know who August Christ is.
Who's that?
Exactly. Exactly. He used to be a Grand Wizard. He was one of the dudes who was on like Jerry Springer years back. Wow. Yeah, he's an interesting character. Have you ever heard the term carpetbagger or scallywag?
I have heard that. I thought that was a pirate term, scallywag.
I thought so too until I researched this.
I guess.
Do you know that term?
I do, yes.
You want to explain it?
Well, no, you explain it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Carpetbaggers were people from the north who arrived with only a satchel with the chance of making money off of their new surroundings, usually against the wishes of the people who lived there. So the term carpetbagger was what people called a guy wearing a suit coming down from the north to make some money, right? But the scallywags law is, the term for scallywags is like small-time farmers and merchants who felt that the rights of black people should be recognized. Many of these people were loyal to the Union during the Civil War. So now we have identifiable terms, right? That's good. So now we can make laws against them. So don't let either one of those people stand next to black people. That's illegal. Don't let them have conversations in public. Those are part of the black codes.
Wow. Control right. Who you talk to.
Right.
You sound surprised.
You know, I'm not super familiar with the black codes. Like I said, I read about it a couple of years ago, but it was in passing. And even the little research I did was kind of cursory at best, I would say. Just, you know, kind of skimming over. Okay, this is what it was. Okay, but Uncommon sounds like he's done a lot more research. So.
It's difficult to research the black codes right. Because there's not, I mean, unless I haven't found the book yet that is just a comprehensive, just black codes book. And in most cases, you have to kind of dig around and you have to search what were the laws that happened in that arose in this state in the 1860s. And then what were the laws that came up in this state in the 1860s? I'm sure someone's done the research. I just haven't read that book yet.
So were they overturned with the Civil Rights Act of 1866?
The 14th Amendment really overturned quite a bit of the black codes.
What year was that?
The 14th Amendment was, I wrote that down. I don't remember. I'll get back to
it. I'll Google it.
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay.
But yeah, it was the ratification of the 13th and the 14th Amendments that kind of did away with the black codes, because those were the official, the 14th was the official end of slavery. Go ahead, D.
There's a way to see how they kind of, they did away with something. But I think one of the lessons to be learned from all of this is that it was reinvented again in order to be able to continue that same suppression, you know, of black folks. You know, if you don't want to use the word black codes, we can use the word black laws. If you don't want to use that word, we can use the word
Jim Crow.
Slavery laws. That's where I'm going. Jim Crow.
And that was the 60s, right?
Yeah. And then if you don't want to use that word, we can start talking about Jim Crow, you know, and then, I mean, we can bring it right up to today as we sit here. You see what I mean? Codes were made, legal shenanigans were written and done. I dare say that, you know, you had to be in a certain group of people in order to understand what the law was, because they were in a position to interpret the law. I hope I'm not getting too far from it, but, you know, the people now becomes the representatives. And so whether it's the House of Representatives, which has so many people, and then we have the Senate, which has less, and now the Supreme Court, which is 9, you know, interpreting the law.
Yeah.
You see? So there's a system that's been set up, and that's my takeaway on this. You know, I hope I'm not getting to the end too quickly, but we can sit and research, you know, legal people go through research and they start looking in books that are in libraries all over the place, you know, in order to be able to get their authorities. I think that's what they call them, you know, and when they go into a judge, they say, well, this said here, this said there, blah, 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 blah. And that's the reason why it supports our opinion and you should judge it that way, you know. And then the other side says, well, we saw this and this and this and this and this, and that's why you should judge the way, and it goes back and forth. But the fact that these folks are in a position to be able to make judgment is the issue, you know, because their intent is to maintain slavery, dominance, submissiveness, indebtedness, and on and on and on and on and on and on.
I think your comment perfectly encapsulates the idea that I had when I chose to speak about this today, because you can see a through line. If you're looking at history through the lens of the Black Codes, you can see a through line from pre-slavery all the way to today. And not only the laws that have been created, but the mindset behind them. You see what I mean? That mindset has never been even adjusted. It hasn't.
I think that's what we need to, you know, we need to realize what time it is. I mean, you know, we need to understand the environment that we're living in.
Yeah, because everybody ain't living your best life. You just think you are.
These folks who were protesting, you know, Black Lives Matter specifically, and I don't want to get in trouble with anybody who is a member of that organization. You know, I applaud them for doing that. I've chosen not to do it that way anymore because I've already done it several times. You know, and the idea that they're asking someone to give them something, I appreciate the fact that they're doing that, and I'm glad they're out there, because without them making all that noise, you know, and protesting and you know, standing up to the police and all this other stuff, you know, a lot of attention would not be given to the issues at hand. However, it's not the only way, and in combination with those overt protests, you know, other things need to happen too. I personally feel, guys, tell me what you think. We need to vote as well. You know, don't give up on it. That's part of the solution. It's a part of the solution. You know, I think the biggest one comes when we boycott, which basically means we're voting with our dollars and we, you know, support the things with the money that we got, our own community or whatever, you know, and then we withdraw support when we don't agree with it. You see?
You know,
what do you think?
I have something for that, but I'm going to save that for the end when we start talking about action steps.
Dang it.
I'm going to save that for the end. So you had something.
That's where I think I'm living. I'm living in what's the reaction to it. You know what I mean? It's good to know what's going on, but what is our reaction to it? But if you said that's later.
No, you do your part now.
I would say, I think it's Claude Anderson said something similar that you have. You've said, you know Claude Anderson?
Oh, I love Claude Anderson.
Okay, Dr. Claude Anderson said that we need to let our Black dollars bounce in our community 14 to 17 times. He goes through it, you know, he has that kind of brain.
Yes.
But then he said to start buying power at another level. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So councilmen and mayors, and once we are big enough with our dollar, because my family, my household, we do not celebrate Christmas. The Black dollar is responsible for over $1 trillion spent on Christmas, from Jordans to Xboxes. We continue to make other people rich. I had to cut it out. And when I found a wife, I told her, this is my plan. As a man, this is where I'm going. I want my money to bless people. And so we do not celebrate Christmas. And I got to tell you, and I'm not calling for everybody to stop. I'm not doing that. But I got to tell you that our money is used to bless people, our friends, those around us. And it feels so much better than to get a bunch of innocuous things that really won't make us happier. But I think that boycott with our dollars, you know, just like they did the bus boycott. And when they realized they weren't getting that Black dollars, they really had to start changing something. People aren't going to move until they start losing those dollars. That's when they start to get behind. And I don't know. I mean, I can go all day, but I think a lot of this stuff is a high sign now, where this is what they always do. They take a Black cause and then they say, well, civil rights. No, no, no. We want Black rights. We want this for Black people. Well, we need that for everybody. Sure, there has to be parity, but I think we need to look out for what are our standards, what do we want first, and we need to lay that down. Like, no, this needs to come into our community, not, oh, well, that should go to everyone. Because what I found, correct me if I'm wrong, you guys seem to be more versed in history, is that if you put out something there, like a, you know, a law or some kind of money that you're trying to give to a certain group of people, there are people out there slick enough to take that money when they're not part of that group. For instance, there was money out there for the Indians, and there were white guys that were a fifth or 10% Indian, and they were collecting the money that was made for the Native Americans. And the same thing are going for, you know, women in power. When you look at the what is it called, for the colleges, what was it called, the
affirmative action,
that helped white women more than it helped anyone else.
Well, I can tell you, I know exactly what you're talking about with people who were just a part Indian. How about people who were no part Indian? They're actually called $5 Indians.
Yep.
That's the exact term. And what happened is the commission that was responsible for getting a census on Indians in the time when they were just after the, I forget what the name of the act was, they basically put word out, hey, we'll put you on this Indian registry and it only costs $5. You get your whole family on. And that's why you see so many Caucasian people, obvious Caucasian people that run around here and live on these reservations and call themselves Indians. And I'll be honest with you, you know that they're not fucking Indians because they call themselves Indians because Indians don't want to be called Indians.
Right. They want to be called usually by their tribe or, yeah. you know, and it's funny that you say that. And this is meant to be a joke, you know, so I don't want anybody to take it like, because now women are amassing power. And I'm going to tell you, white men are so slick, they've started to now become women to get that money. I just think it's a constant undermining of what's supposed to be allocated to the right people. And I can't, it can't be pointed at one person or whatever it is, but it's a constant, that undermining. If they started to give something to black people, you'll see Eminem would be black and...
I need some clarification on that one before you go any further.
Women have started to amass power.
No, not that part. The part where you said that white men are starting to become women to get said power. Because I want to know some details on that one. What are we talking about here?
Bruce Jenner. I mean, look at those things. Like, okay, all I'm saying is, look, and it's just it's all love.
You're gonna
let
that one slide by?
I'm not gonna let it slide by. I think you're, you know, but think about it. Like the new thing now, are women are really rising up. They're doing their thing, and that's great. But now we have an influx of transgendered women grabbing this power, grabbing the spotlight, being called courageous, taking things away. I think it was Carrie Hilson who had a Black Girls Rock, and she had to check a man who was dressing like a woman, you know, from taking certain accolades of the black girls. Let me not overtalk
you. No, I get that.
It's just a joke, but I'm just saying I've noticed, and this is, I'm telling you guys, this is not well researched, but I've noticed that whenever that there is money getting doled out, fame, power, whatever, certain types of people will adjust themselves so they can receive that.
Oh, no, absolutely. I agree with that. I agree with that part. Yeah. As far as the homosexual or trans agenda, personally, I don't care. I don't care. I don't have to be necessarily exposed to it. Have you ever heard of a show called P-Valley? You're not going to want to watch it. Most, you know, honestly, you might want to watch it.
It's a cartoon?
No, it's not at all. It's an adult show. It's P-Valley stands for Pussy Valley. And the show is about a strip club and all the characters that work in the strip club. So they do show quite a lot of women stripping.
Oh, like the Players Club. I remember that movie.
Right. But unlike the Players Club, see every movie you've seen about strippers before, they make the strippers all like what your stereotypical idea of a stripper is. But in this TV show, they don't do that. Right. They actually do a very good job of personalizing the strippers and letting you know, like it's a job and they have a life outside of that and showing what their lives are like outside of their work. They show quite a bit of that. But the interesting thing to the show is, and it's super popular, but there's some homosexual activity. There's some homosexual activity. One of the character who runs the club is a character named Uncle Clifford, and he's not trans. He's just a crossdresser. You know, like he hasn't done the surgery or nothing like that. But he messes around with a rapper within the show. And watching the show, I was nervous and uncomfortable watching the gay scenes, but I mean, that's the extent of my gayness is watching it on TV. So whenever I see other people, I mean, I don't have to put myself in your shoes. I don't have to accept or deflect what you do. I just have to look the other way if I don't like it. You know what I mean? Because that's always a choice. And that's just my personal belief. Because I'm an atheist, that's part of my mantra is to live and let others live. You know what I mean? So I don't think I necessarily have the... I can't tell another person how to live their life, and I don't have to. I'm not bothered by your experiences, and you shouldn't be bothered necessarily by mine. You know, that's just where I land on the gay thing. But I notice a lot of people that are upset because they see it more, because it's on TV more, and these people they have a whole movement, and they want to be identified, and they want to be recognized, and sometimes it's something within us that is the reason that we're bothered when we see those people. You see what I'm saying? It's like, I don't like you because I've always been told that I shouldn't like you. But typically when you get to know some of these people, like I have gay friends. And if it wasn't for the fact that I knew that they were gay, I typically wouldn't know that they were gay. You know what I mean? I work construction. I'm around a few gay guys, and for some reason, people are more comfortable talking to me. I don't know why, because I'm not gay, and I guess it's once they know that you know one gay guy on the job, then the rest of them are more comfortable to talk to you, because it's not something that they talk about on the job a lot. But I know a couple guys, and like I said, it is what it is. You do you, I do me.
Wow, that was was interesting.
What's your response to that?
Okay, you guys poking Uncle Dre. Yeah, I love everyone. I really believe that everyone deserves dignity, humanity, respect. Right. As far as like, you know, do I have gay friends? Yes, I have gay friends. I have friends that are liars. I have friends that are greedy. I have friends that are murderers. I have friends that cheat on their wives. I have friends that do everything.
Right.
You know what I mean? But as a Christian, I cannot ratify that behavior. But in the same vein, I can't, what am I going to do? They're people. I'm not going to beat them down. I'm not going to hold them back. You do what you. And if I have to perform a service, I'm going to perform it no matter who you are. But I can't ratify that behavior. And in my household, we won't be watching anything like that personally.
I ain't mad at you.
And that's respectful. But let's jump back on the topic. You know.
Yeah, I was just looking at that.
Okay.
So.
Well, allow me to say this then. One of the interesting thing about the black codes, or the slave codes, their intent, you know, was that they took. So now you weren't working on Massa's land anymore, you know. So you maybe went out and got a little piece of land of your own. Well, this is the time when land was wealth,
mm-hmm.
because the wealth was coming from the products that you produced, the things that you grew, you know, timber, cotton, tobacco, wheat, whatever it happened to be, potatoes, you know, yams, you know. So it was coming out of the agricultural growth of things on the land. And so that gave them a sense of, you know, empowerment. They were becoming independent. Oh, says the white man. The people that thought to try to create these black codes, oh, we got to figure out a way to get them off their land. Now, there's lots of ways to do that. How about taxing? You know, how about, like you were saying before, the idea of, you got to buy this, and so we overcharge you on this, and then when we got to buy your produce, we drop, you know, we knock the price down, you know, and so you end up going into debt. Debt became a weapon,
mm-hmm.
you know.
He talked about that.
Yeah. You know, education, the lack thereof, can't read, can't write. You sign something, you know, that you can't read because you were still thinking, well, you know, I'll take his word for it because that's the way we've been operating, you know. And then, oh, no, dude, I got it on paper now, see, the new law. You see, how about not being able to own property, right? How about not being able to vote? You kind of see how insidious that is?
You know, you said something just now, and it's just something I want you to put a pin in. Just now when you started that statement, you said that they were using these laws to move people off of their land.
Yeah.
Put a pin in that, because we're going to come back to that. Because the essay that I wrote, a lot of it is wrapped around that exact idea. Moving people off of their land, mm-hmm. which is exactly the same idea as what happened in Seneca Village as well.
Well, I'll put a pin in it, you know. But you know where I was going with that, you know, past, present, future. You know, it's still the same thing.
I like the way you come at it. I think what you're trying to say makes a lot of sense. And I mean, because land is the one resource you can't make any more of. You know, it's the one resource you can't make any more of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and to control that or to take that from someone is, man, you're right, insidious, because that affects generations to come down. Because now, yes. instead of having our own land, we now live on your land. Right. So we have to pay right. you
yes.
to reside, just to live. We have to pay you to reside, just that's
to,
evil.
To exist. To
property
exist.
Tax.
To exist.
You know, rent.
Right.
Yeah. You know, look how many people are having difficulty now because now they can't work. Because somebody said so. Right. You know what I mean?
Right. Or the rent hikes of yeah. New York and yes. of Silicon Valley. Like, they're one bedrooms for like $4,000.
And of Inglewood.
And of Inglewood, that's right.
The Ram Stadium is called gentrification in Inglewood like nobody's business. You can't find a one bedroom for less than, $3,000 a month?
Get out of here.
I heard about 27. So that's close enough to $3,000.
Yeah. Yeah, it's ridiculous. Now, you talked about an interesting through line from past to present, and another interesting through line that the black codes bring us from past to present is this idea that white people are the, no matter who you are, you can just walk up to a black person and start policing them.
Oh, I get that, but good not one. On the level you're probably going to talk about. I get that.
Well, I mean, think about it. It's at this point, I'm almost wondering if it's something that it's ingrained in their culture.
Oh, call it privilege.
Yeah, it's something I don't think they can help way. It.
Yeah.
Because think about it. Historically, you have throughout slavery. See, people look at slavery and ask, well, why didn't more of them escape? Because they couldn't. Because white people were an army. They were an army. Everywhere you went, every single white person had the job of checking you and making sure that you were not out of place. It wasn't just slave patrols. Every white person was part of the slave patrols. That's what the slave patrols were.
Have you seen Django Unchained? That's what that reminds me.
Yeah.
When he was on the horse.
Yes.
And the whole town was like running and calling. I see what you're saying.
But there's truth in that.
Because it was illegal for them to be on the horse.
That's how it was. That's how it was. Where everybody, see, well, people don't understand what the actual slave patrols were. The slave patrols entitled every single white person to play police over every single black person that they seen. And then the black codes reinforced that even after slavery was gone. And then Jim Crow reinforced that even after slavery was gone. So now today we have Karen who walks up to the barbecue full of people who are minding their business and calls the police because she doesn't think they should be there.
Now, you know, just for clarification, for my clarification, because I'm going to have my listeners listen to this. You're not saying that we don't need no police or anything like that, right? You're saying there should be some law enforcement, even if it's our own. You're not saying like nothing. Is that?
I'm not the type of person who thinks that we need to absolutely 100% abolish the police.
Okay, I didn't think so either.
I do have ideas that because the police the way they exist today are a recipe for disaster. And the reason being is that if you look at the police before all of them were driving around in cars, they had to walk a beat. They were called beat cops.
That's true.
And when they walked a beat, the cops in the area knew the neighborhood. They knew who was likely to fuck up. They knew who was likely to steal something. They knew who was likely to murder somebody. They knew the people who had mental difficulties. They knew the neighborhood. And now they're just the guys who ride up and shoot you. They don't have any personal connection to the neighborhood. Mm. And they say that's because they're in fear for their lives. But if you weren't being an asshole, you wouldn't be in fear for your life. You see what I'm saying? Being a cop is a choice. It's a choice. I can't change my black skin. Well, I can, but I don't want to.
Okay, all right. Yeah,
I'm not willing to bleach. You see what I'm saying?
But I think you could say that policing. See, and we use that word to, you know, it means different things to different people. But you could see that policing was yet another episode in the black codes.
Yes.
You see, so it wasn't as obvious as it was, 100 years ago, 125, 150 years ago, you know. But now, mm-hmm. policing, where, you know, you can't do this and you can't do that, and, your taillight's broken, so now we're going to stop. You know, your tags are out. You know, you're driving around a car that's all beat up, or you got a cracked windshield. You know, I mean, there's so many, just drive up to somebody and let me see your registration, you know. That's happened to me. That might be worth a story. You know,
go ahead, shoot it.
Okay, well, you know, I'm going to a scuba diving class, you know, out in Malibu, and it's 4:30 in the morning. You know, I got a real slick little sports car, you know, and, you know, and I'm driving. I'm just driving, going to the, you know, I got to be there by 5:00. You know, and here comes the woo, the lights and all that, you know, and the guy walks up to me with the big light, you know, look like, you know, I can't even see him because the light's so bright, you know, but what I can see is that he got his hand on his gun. And I said, oh, shit, here we go. Okay, put my hands on the steering wheel, right? You know, and, you know, where you going, boy? And I...
He said, boy.
And that
I got one for you.
Blew up, you know, and something said, nope, you don't even have to respond. Just put your hands back on the steering wheel. I put my hands back on the steering wheel. Said, where are you going, boy? Didn't you hear me? And I said, well, officer, I can't even open up the window because I got to keep my hands on the steering wheel so you can see where they are. You know, are you trying to be smart? I said, no, I'm just trying to be safe. I said, now, can I roll the window down? Is it all right with you? You know, I had to play that kind of part. You see? Okay, I'm going to take my left hand off. We had power windows on that car, right? You know, and I hit the little button, roll the window down. You know, and all the time I'm watching his hand on that gun.
Uh-huh.
You see? So I was able to get to the point where I was able to basically, to make the story short, talk his hand off the gun.
You know.
You see? I mean, other things happen too, but that's policing. You see, I'm on a public road minding my own business. You know, I finally said to him, well, you know, if you look in the back, officer, you will see that I have scuba diving equipment because I'm a scuba diving instructor. You know, and I'm going out to so-and-so beach, and I need to be there in about another 20 minutes because they're expecting me. I had to talk my way out of this fool's presence, which is the way I've learned how to do it. I mean, I've driven cross-country a couple of times. I've run into others, you know. But the idea is that I got to be aware of the police. I don't be like some of the younger brothers, you know. They're going to wow, wow, boo, 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 boo. Look, I ain't got time for that. The idea is to get away from them as quickly as possible. Don't even be in their presence.
Can I ask you what year this was?
No.
Oh. Yeah, this was in 1996.
I wonder if that could have been the a response to him seeing a black man in a nicer car than he can afford.
Now, let me say this.
I don't care. You know, just leave me to blank alone. You know,
right,
I mean,
right.
He felt like we said earlier that he could just stop me. And but he's coming like with his hand on his gun. Like, you know, that's how scared he is. You see what I mean? He could have shot me. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to be nowhere near him because once you get put into their custody, they can say anything and do anything.
Right.
You see, so that's why I'm using this as an example of modern day black codes.
I had a cop pull a gun on me in my house. You've been trying to say something. I'm gonna let you go.
You know what, Uncommon? This is a ripe area. I think every black man has had their experience with the cops, and I want to go into it, but I do. I know we're not here for that, so I don't want to go too much into it. But I'm just gonna say this: I am the son of a law enforcement officer. Good. I'm gonna say that, right?
Good.
And I also am the grandson of a radical that's been pulled over by the cops and thrown into jail and, you know, distrustful of the police. So I get both from my mother's side and from my father's side. I would say a good balance. And like I said, I can talk about this. I think you should make this another topic. I would love to come back and talk about this. So I'm going to just end it right there.
Oh, we have that show planned already.
Okay, perfect. And please invite me back. Yeah. I'm going to end it there. It's a deeper issue, but just like David said, he said that, you know, he had a cooler head and things prevailed in a good way. I don't want to praise or demonize a whole group of anyone. I don't want to, because what happens is the head cult, the bigger majority, will praise them to the heavens and then miss that whatever percent, whether you want to say 50, 80, 20, 10% of the bad ones that need to get out of that profession and should never be in there. And then we have another group, whoever it may be, would demonize them so much to where now I'm hearing calls of abolish police. We don't need any police. Those are anarchists, and those people scare me. I can't even lie. Either extreme scares me.
I can tell you from my personal experience. I'm a veteran. I'm a combat veteran. After getting out of the military, I promised myself, for myself, that I would never work for the government again, because I was in places where I felt like I was being forced to be the bully to other brown people on behalf of white people. Now, that was my personal belief, right? I'm not telling anyone else how to believe or what to think, but I'm also saying that I made the choice to get myself out of that I was never, ever going to work on behalf of this government again. Now, what I will say is, if you work a job where your compatriots are terrible people and you've done nothing to work towards making the job better,
you're part of the problem. Exactly.
If you're willing to invoke the thin blue line, you're part of the problem. If you're willing to say that a blue life matters over a black life, you're part of the problem, because there's no such thing as a blue life. Now, I do feel for people who choose that as a career, as a profession, because I understand that you're always on alert because your life is in jeopardy a lot of the time. But I think, similar to the U.S. government, the police here, the police on the local level, create a lot of their own problems. And then in creating those problems, they create those problems and people point out those problems, then they start to act like, okay, well, we're the victim here. No. What's happening in the streets right now, the way the police are responding to protesters with violence, it's only working to affirm what the protesters already believe. If we're protesting because you're violent, then you show us violence what's the logical next step? I mean, I can see why people are calling for abolishing the police. I'm personally not of the belief that you can't have any law enforcement, but what you can have is law enforcement officers that work with mental health officers, because most of the jobs that they show up on, most of the calls that they show up on, are really better suited by people who can deal with mental health. A lot of them.
Should they not be armed with any kind of, at least a taser? Because, I mean, a mental health person, if they're a danger to themselves or others, that's a violent person either way. I mean, they have to protect themselves and the other people that are there. I'm just asking. You know?
No. I would never suggest that they not be armed. But far too often, the gun makes the situation worse.
Amen. I think of Tamir Rice. Within 12 seconds of pulling up, they shot that young man.
How about the guy from Barstow? What was it, like 2 years ago? He was in his backyard. They gave him 3 seconds to comply, and then they killed him.
That right there, I can only say that's evil. I don't know what to say, because all lives matter. No matter where you just want to take somebody's life like that.
Right.
But what I will have to say, and I'm just saying as a mitigating aspect of this, is, you know, like I said, I have a radical side of my family, and I have a non-radical side. And I don't believe, just like you affirm that too, that let's just abolish everything. Like, I don't think that's wise, because I don't want my grandma, who lives alone, for someone to come in her house because she looks like a target. Who does she call? I live an hour away. By the time I'm there, whatever's going to happen is already going to happen.
Right.
But someone who can respond in 6 minutes and is supposed to have her best interest at heart, right? And we know sometimes it doesn't work out like that, would be, I would say, preferable, right?
Right. Don't get me twisted. Don't misunderstand. I have liberal ideas, but I'm also the owner of two AR-15s.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? Like, I'm not going to play those games with nobody, and I don't suggest my family do either.
But see, Uncommon, you're a big, strong man who can take care of your family. You may not even need to call the cops. You can handle that, right? So is David. So am I. We can handle that. But it's for... You know, before we got married, my wife lived alone, and none of her family really lived in close proximity. It would be good to have someone who, at least with the, you know, the sirens coming down the street, that person can flee. The cops are coming. That does invoke fear, you know. But yes, there are a lot on there that are doing evil things, because I saw the video of what's my man's name? George Floyd. And me and my wife teared up when we saw the 8 minutes on this man's neck. I know, and I just don't know what to say, man.
Well, you said that the sounds of sirens invoke fear in criminals, but they also invoke fear in innocent people sometimes, too.
A lot of times.
And that's the unfortunate truth of 2020. But I'm going to leave it on that.
Yes.
I got an essay. And
we are ready.
Now, I'm going to tell you guys a story, and it's going to suck. And this is a disclaimer for the entire audience. The following story is unsuitable for young children. Now, what if I told you that this story includes California representatives trying to ban black people from the state, but by the time I get to that point of the story, you won't even care. Dr. Joy in the passage speaks about the exclusionary acts in the 1850s in the Oregon Territory, but she doesn't go into great detail. The reason for that is this particular period could be a book of its own. In fact, it is. Let me ask you fellas a question. Do you know who California's first governor is?
Nope.
I think he was a black Mexican, I think.
Nope. His name was Peter Burnett.
Now he became governor under whose decree?
Oh, I'm gonna get to all that right now. But before we talk about what he did in California, let me go through some background. Peter Burnett was born in Nashville, Tennessee on November 15th, 1807, but he lived most of his early life in Missouri. He was a well-known lawyer in Missouri who actually represented Joseph Smith, the founder of Mormonism, when he went to trial after the Mormon Wars. In 1843, after several failed businesses, he scraped together enough money to finance the first major wagon train to Oregon. He tried his hand at farming, which didn't last long, but having the ability to fail upwards, as many white people do, he got into politics. He served on the Oregon legislature between 1844 and 1848, and this is where we get into the exclusionary acts that Dr. Joy was speaking of, because he also served as the supreme judge for the provisional government of Oregon for 1845 to 1846. Now, he used this position of power to write into law what would later be known as Peter Burnett's Lash Law. You guys ever heard of that one?
No, but I think I can imagine when you say lash.
So what do you think? What do you think it is?
The right to whip slaves.
Somebody get beat.
Yeah.
not necessarily whipped slaves. Remember I told you earlier that Oregon was the only state that when it was incepted to the U.S. was
that means
not,
exclude slaves.
Uh-huh. That's what it was. It was to exclude slaves. So Burnett's lash law had one goal.
Beat them out.
Yep. Blacks in Oregon, whether they be free or slave, man or woman, be whipped twice a year, up to 39 lashes until he or she shall quit the territory.
And leave.
Yep. And see, when Oregon became part of the U.S., it did not allow black people there. It is the only state that can say that.
Insidious, I keep saying.
Yeah. So
evil, you keep saying.
Now, our friend here, Peter Burnett, has a cushy job and a comfortable life in Oregon. What do you think would bring him to California?
Land.
Well, that would be the same thing that brought most of the other scum from the Midwest and the East.
So the gold?
The gold rush. The same thing that brought tons of white men from to Northern California in the 1850s, the gold rush. He left Oregon with his nephew, but didn't make it as rich as he thought, as he would finding gold. But he had the law to rely on, and a rapidly growing town to take advantage of it in, and that town would be San Francisco.
This is starting to sound familiar.
Uh-huh. Are you guys ever been to San Francisco?
Yeah. I regret ever going to San Francisco.
Tell me about it.
Not because of what you think. I just didn't like it. I don't like bridges. I accidentally ended up on the Golden Gate Bridge. I almost peed myself. And it was like night, and I nudged my boy, and he was kind of scared too. And we just got lost. It just was horrible. I just don't like it. And we ended up in like the worst part, almost like the Skid Row of there. We were lost. Oh. It was just a horrible.
Were you in San Francisco or Oakland?
No, we were in San Francisco. I actually didn't think it was too bad, but we were in San Francisco.
It's more comfortable. So okay. I used to work in the refineries, and I worked for this company called Catalyst Services, and we had some guys from our Trinidad division come out, and we used to do a lot of work in the Bay Area. So we're working in the Bay Area, and we take a trip with these guys over to San Francisco, and they decide that they wanted to go hang out in one of the clubs. And so we kind of told them, hey, man, that might not be the club. Because there was a symbol out front that had like a rainbow thing in it. And one of the guys that I was working with knew the place well. So, yeah, exactly. So they go in there, and about 5 minutes later, this fucking big Trinidadian dude comes, he's getting thrown out of the place, but he's screaming, "Maracan, you Maracan, don't you touch me. Give me my pants." Why are your pants off, bro? They make you take your pants off as soon as you walk in there. Say, okay, well, we tried to tell you, bro.
Insanity, man.
He thought it was a different kind of club, and yeah, like, that would be a good thing. Like, shoot, right to the action.
We tried to tell you, but that was his experience with San Francisco. So
should have listened, bro.
Yeah, should have listened, bro. So now I'm about to make you aware of a team name that's super problematic, and it's not the Redskins. California became a state in 1848 as one of the spoils of the Spanish-American War. The California government committed a genocide on the native population to make room for the influx of white settlers for the gold rush known as the 49ers. In fact, on June 19, 2019, Governor Newsom had a press conference for a public acknowledgement and apology for the genocide of 16,000 natives, which I believe to be a very low number, and I'll tell you why later. Go for it.
Governor Newsom apologized to the Spanish people that they killed?
Spanish and native, yeah.
In the plan of action, I'll share that on that.
Okay. The 49ers, along with the U.S. Cavalry, annihilated thousands of American Aboriginals. And I should let you guys know, sometimes I say Native, sometimes I say American Aboriginal. It means the same thing, but I try not to say Indian. I might slip up and say it through the course of this essay because a lot of the things that I was reading called them Indians. So it might slip up. Now, how you guys doing? Sticking in there?
I'm good. I'm enjoying it.
Okay, we're going deep. Have you ever heard of the Bloody Island Massacre?
Philippines? Magellan? What?
Nope, here in California.
Oh, no.
All right. Well, this next part kind of sucks, so my apologies for in advance, but this is just one example of the extermination campaign that the California government ran against the natives here. So, after being enslaved and starved by two white cattle ranchers for more than 2 years, the members of the Pomo Indian tribe rose up and killed their captors. Starving might be considered an understatement. These two men were incredibly brutal. They only provided 4 cups of wheat per day to the individuals within the tribe, and allowed the and they would not allow the Pomo to fish or feed themselves from the land. The two men sexually abused women and children, including the wife of Pomo chief Augustine. They tell the story of a young boy who was sent to ask for more wheat. either that or he insulted Kelsey's wife, depending on which story you've read. There are a couple of different versions of the story, but what is not disputed in any of the stories is that they sentenced the boy to 100 lashings, and then after the lashings, they shot him in the head. Now think about this brutality. They lashed him and then kill him. If you were going to kill him anyway, why would you lash him? The Pomo must have felt the same way as I do. It was a needless level of extra cruelty to an execution. So, you got something, I can see it.
That's making me cringe. That's horrible. That's horrible. It's cognitive dissonance, where they're not humans anymore. They're not humans anymore.
He brought up my term.
they're not human. You have to look at someone as non-human to do that. That level of brutality to a child.
To a child.
It reminds me of the doctor, the father of modern gynecology, how he practiced on slave women, mm-hmm. and he believed that
they had a higher level of pain.
Tolerance pain. Of pain. Yeah. So he didn't even put anesthesia as he cut these women open. They're vaginal. They're I cringe hearing things like that. It's hard. Go on ahead, bro.
Yeah, it's rough. You got some MD? You doing good over there?
Well, it doesn't surprise me. keep on with the story because it doesn't surprise me. No, okay.
Doesn't surprise I'm kind of hip either, to it. But you know, come on, any story of human violence like that just hurts me.
I'm gonna be honest with you. There were points writing this essay where I almost cried. This is a rough story. So continuing, the Pomo men killed the two men and fled to an island known as Bonipoti in the Pomo language. Kelsey's brother, unable to see who was actually at fault, blinded by his privilege, rounded up a posse and they killed every native that they seen. But the tribe who had escaped to the island was tracked down by the U.S. cavalry. The island, which had cultural significance, was once a place where local tribes would gather for fish spawning season, was now a death trap as the cavalry scouts moved in with heavy artillery. The unit was the 1st Dragoons Regiment of the U.S. Cavalry, led by Captain Nathaniel Lyons. Here's a quote from Nathaniel Lyons. Quote, "The island became a perfect slaughtering pen," unquote. It's unclear to see exactly how many people died in this incident. Every source I've seen quotes at least 200, but that's because that's the number of people accounted for within the tribe. But it's impossible to account for the number of random attacks by vigilante groups. This is the number they use, 200. But we know the number to be more. This is the reason I take issue with the 16,000 person genocide that Gavin Newsom apologized for. How exactly are you counting that? One of the few Pomo survivors was a 6-year-old girl named Nika. She survived by hiding underwater and breathing through a tool reed. I tried to find out how long she was underwater, but I couldn't find any detailed account of her perspective, or at least for a while. I did know she changed her name later on in life to Lucy Moore, and that her descendants set up the Lucy Moore Foundation, so I went there looking for some details. Would you like to know what I found?
I'm all ears.
Me too.
All right. I'm getting close to wrapping this up, but it's all going to come back around full circle. But I did manage to find out how her descendants described the incident on her behalf. They describe soldiers and militia bayoneting Pomo men, women, children, and elders, bayoneting women and babies, stepping on and crushing infants, braining them. Would you like to know what braining is?
No, I'm going to.
You probably don't want to. It's a 19th century term that's used for picking up kids by their feet and smashing their heads against trees, knocking their brains out. Continuing, few Pomo survived. It took 5 days to gather the bodies for cremation. Nika, a.k.a. Lucy Moore, however, became a mother, a grandmother, and a great-grandmother. She lived to be 110 years old, and she prayed every day for God to forgive America. I'm sorry to go off on a tangent, but I feel it's important to tell the stories and discuss the stories of survivors. So, now let's bring it around full circle. You know that part that I started with about telling you that by the time I get to the point of the story about California trying to ban black people that you wouldn't even care? How you feeling about that right now?
Yeah, I don't care.
Well, we're at that part. He more or less enacted Burnett's lash law from Oregon. But to tell this part of the story, we're going to have to rewind back just a little bit to the California Convention. Now, California became a state in 1848, but the California Convention took place in 1849. Now, our boy was the governor who addressed the convention, and you can read his entire speech at governors.library.ca.gov. I read the entire speech. First, he argues that California should pull a Missouri, but not in those exact words. He alluded to the Missouri Compromise, wherein Missouri kind of forced the U.S. to observe its rights as a slave state. Then he announced the new state law of taxation, and he suggested a poll property tax, I'm sorry, a poll tax on the actual value of a person's property, also making public the penalties for not paying your taxes. Then he got into what we should do with all the newly freed black citizens. He left the statesmen two choices in the matter. On the one hand, they could admit them in, they could admit them to the full free enjoyment and all the privilege guaranteed under the Constitution to those, to others. I'll repeat. He left the statesmen's two choices for how to handle the issue. On the one hand, they could admit them to the full freedom and enjoyment of all privileges guaranteed under the Constitution to others, or they could exclude them from the state entirely. Basically, the same thing as in Oregon. Either let them be fully free or kick them out of the
state. Leave.
Kick them out of the state.
Kick them out, yeah.
And now we get into what his argument was. Then he went on to persuade the convention that the easy thing to do would be to get them out. Here's a quote from his speech. A few years delay will make it almost, if not quite impossible, to do that in which could be so easily accomplished right now. In California, if California will take a decided stand and firmly maintain it, after a few years experience will demonstrate the practical utility of the measure. That weak and sickly sympathy, that misplaced mercy, that would hesitate to adopt this salutary measure today, but would suffer all the inevitable consequences of tomorrow, may consider the policy I propose harsh in its character, but if it is calculated to produce the greatest good to the greatest number, it is the best humanity. Imagine that, he calls this humanity. It could be no favor and no kindness to permit the class of population to settle in the state under such humiliating circumstances, although they may think otherwise. While it would be a most serious injury to us, we have certainly the right to prevent any class of population from settling in our state that we seem injurious to our society. Had they been born here, I should not recommend any measure to expel them. They are not here now, except a few in comparison with the numbers that would be here, and the object is to keep them out. I therefore call your most serious attention to this subject, believing it to be one of most importance. Depending on the source, some sympathetic to Burnett call him an abolitionist, although he once owned slaves himself. But the truth is, he was a different type of abolitionist. He didn't really give a shit about freeing anybody. He thought slavery was a bad look. He thought it made white people look bad to enslave other people. He didn't really care. He didn't really care where black people were, as long as it wasn't in his state. There were several other politicians at the time that thought in line with Burnett. Some advocated for genocide as well. The state should not allow blacks and natives to intermingle because they would become an unstoppable force that would eventually overtake whites. It seems that much of their history is aimed at this solitary thought, holding other groups back. That's also called maintaining white supremacy. For this essay, I sourced the book, The Troubled Life of Peter Burnett. The ACLU has a series called Gold Chains, The Hidden History of Slavery in California. History.com has three articles that you should read called California's Little Known Genocide, California Slaughtered 16,000 Native Americans, and California Once Tried to Ban Black People. There's also a Lake County News article that talks about the Lucy Moore Foundation story. And there's also an Atlantic article that you should read called The Real 49ers. I'm sorry, The Real History of the 49ers. There's an NPR article that I read on Peter Hardman Burnett called California's First Governor and Noted Racist. And I also sourced a Face-to-Face Africa article called The Cruel Lash Law of the 1800s that authorized the whipping of blacks twice a year. How you guys feeling?
I think I'm going to steal David. I'm not surprised. Nothing new here.
Well, you know, again, going into it from a historical point, kind of like going into the weeds, you know, dealing with specific dates, quotes, statements, blah, 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 blah. You know, it helps to set up a stronger understanding of how, and I'm going to use the same word I used last time, that's insidious, this is. You know, and I think it's very easy to pull it into what we're living today, the kind of rhetoric that we're hearing, the redefinition of a definition, and it's kind of like sliding values, I suppose. You know, they're flexible, they're adaptable, they're being changed. It makes it difficult to know what to expect and what not to expect, and I think that lies the harm, you know, the injury, you know, being able to think it's one thing and then it turns out to be something else because somebody, just like that guy, what was his name, Bryant?
No, Burnett. Peter Burnett.
Thank you. just like Burnett. You know, we got Burnetts today. Mm-hmm. You know, they're in different positions. They're corporate. They're, you know, government, particularly in states where it seems like more latitude is given. The states are harder to be able to review and, you know, keep track on, because the law is vary from state to state as opposed to the federal level. But I think that's the new trick that's being put out there.
I think what you said is perfect. That perfectly encapsulates how I would be thinking and feeling. Yeah. It's just tricky. It's just tricky.
Yeah. And so we, as far as our people are concerned, us folk, you know, we need to get to a position where, you know, those that don't know need to learn. And there's no excuses about it. It's kind of like I think I said once before, you know, the whole idea of the vote. You know, people going to vote and, you know, is it going to be by mail? Is it this, that? Like, get your butt down to where you need to be. Just go vote, you know, and then be done with that, you know, and move on. There's other things to do besides vote, you see? So the awareness of these things, I think, is helpful. But on the other hand, it's not sufficient in and of itself. You know, more action needs to be taken. So awareness is an important part. Like, you got to be aware of the problem. You got to know that there's a problem. So if you smoke an herb, you know, which is, quote, legal, unquote, or you playing video games, or, you know, you watching, you being entertained, you know, by TV, you know, you listening to your rap song or whatever kind of music it is, you know, if you're just doing you, you know, it seems to me like you got to have a broader view on it in order to be able to be appropriate to the situation, you know, for your own personal safety and the safety of those that you love.
You know, I think it was Umar Johnson. I listen to him a lot. And he said that when they used to take over, like, different countries or whatever, when, you know, whoever would go in there, I guess the spies would go in there, they would first listen to the music that was popular in that country or in that area to find out how to take them over, you know. And I'm not a big music person. I know a couple artists who are friends who love music. And I can kind of take it or leave it. And I don't want to step on nobody's toes that like music. But there is a death style of music that swirls in the Black community. I can't speak for any other community because I'm not a part of any other community. There's a death style of music, I think, that steals our productivity and any unity we can have personally.
Are you talking about rap?
No, not rap. Okay. Not rap per se. Not only rap, but mindset. Okay. Mindset in the music. I think rap is just a genre.
I think in rap and music in general, I think, or at least within the Black community and the music that we produce, I feel like oftentimes you feel people who dumb themselves down and the culture down for dollars.
Amen. And but here's what I'm saying. I think Black people, because in the, was it the late 80s, the most coveted piece of accessory or clothing was a sweatshirt from an HBCU. The most coveted.
Right.
When Public Enemy was out, what is it? Tribe Called Quest, when they were big. And had they continued, I think the Black community would be in a better place. But right about that time, NWA came in. And then the most coveted piece of accessory became a gold chain or a car with rims.
Yeah.
I agree with that. I agree with that 100%. I personally feel like you can tell the same time that the change that you're making happened when it went from being
a pursuit of knowledge.
Right. That's the same time that lyrics no longer became important in hip hop.
Well, see, Uncommon is obviously better at rap history than I am. But in that time span was when I'm going to say it. I mean not to offend anybody, is when our women went from having more natural love for their natural hair and looks to different styles of maybe longer perms and stuff. And it was the time when there was more respect to where now, I'm going to say it, bitches ain't but hoes and, you know,
right, that kind right, of stuff. Right. That mantra.
That mantra. And that music has always made me cringe. And I want to say that I'm a transplant. I'm not from America. I came here from another country. And so I came here when I was about 7 or 8. It took me about 6 years to adapt to the American mindset. And I grew up in Inglewood all that time. And from then on, I knew that I did not want to be a part of whatever or whoever they were speaking about. But as I hung around the kids, I started to start listening to Tupac. And I realized that listening to that music, my mindset changes. Mm-hmm. And it was, what's my man's name? G. Craig Lewis, that said that most gangsters or people who are going to do drive-bys can't just usually do it. They drive around for a while and listen to the music, psych themselves out, get high, and then they can do the thing. So it goes right back full circle to what Umar Johnson was saying. The style of music says a lot about where the people's mindset. And if you're a woman, if the giver of life, your women, can be disrespected in those music, if your manhood can be emasculated or hyper to where you're a maniac, it says a lot. And I think at that level, which is a personal level, just like Brother David was saying, fight back with our dollars. We don't want to hear this. Don't send us this anymore.
I want to have you back for that because you're speaking towards a larger conversation right
now.
Yes, yes. Because I actually have a theory regarding exactly what it was or what period in time we changed. And a lot of it had to do with the crack era. You know what I mean?
War on drugs.
Right. A lot of it had to do specifically with the crack era. And if you look, if you look just before the crack era is when the black family in America was strongest. You see what I'm saying? You have to go back to like the 60s and 70s, but that's the last time that the black family was actually a really whole unit. You see what I'm saying?
And that's my thesis. And always.
But a lot of it is in that era. That era, but I feel as though there was an active plan to attack the black family structure in that period. And so, like I said, that does speak to a larger conversation, which we will have at a later date. But I'm going to get into wrapping this up now. So before we go, do you guys have any social media, email, anywhere where the people can reach out to you, talk to you, touch you, contact you?
Brother David, you're probably more more popular right now than I am.
Well, be that or not be that. I do not at the moment, but my daughter is on my case about that. Yeah, so I got to get that straight because if we continue these conversations, then, I'm very much interested in hearing other people's opinions so we can broaden the conversation. Right. So I will have something soon.
Okay.
Thank you. You can reach me on YouTube, Building Stronger Men. That's three words, Building Stronger Men. And my whole mission is to just have conversation with men, women too, and just talk about real things where we can grow in a community and learn from each other. So Building Stronger Men on YouTube. And if you want to reach me on Twitter, I'm at Men Building, at Men Building, MenBuilding. So reach out, let's talk. If there's something you particularly didn't understand or didn't agree with, let me have a larger conversation. I love to talk to people who really want to talk. I'd appreciate that. Once again, that's Building Stronger Men on YouTube and Twitter. It's at Men Building.
Roger that, roger that. And I am at Creating Black Readers on Instagram. I am Uncommon Sense. You know who I am. You know this voice. Don't make me have to say it again. On TikTok, you can find me at the Black Men's Book Club. Also on YouTube at Black Men's Book Club. We do have a Patreon. If you want to, you can go ahead and pay us for something that we give away for free. But in the future, we're going to be setting up, like I said earlier in the show, a deal with the publisher. And that's what the Patreon's for. We are accepting donations. I don't care if you want to give a quarter or a penny. Anything helps because all this comes out of my pocket. So I think that's enough for the day, guys.
Uncommon, I just want to thank you for inviting me. It's been a pleasure, David. It's amazing meeting you guys. Too. It's been just a humbling conversation, and I really appreciate the respect, whether we agree or not. I would love to look forward to having future conversations like this.
Absolutely, and we would love to have you back. You were awesome today. That's so right. Whoever you are, however you may be listening, wherever you are on the internet, I love you. I want you to love yourself. Be kind to yourself, and we'll see you next time on the Black Man's Book Club. We're going to ride out to a little bit more Robert Glasper. This song is from a compilation album called R&R, and the song is called By Design. We're going to pick it up right in the middle. Have a good one.